and may say, I see his hand of mercy, hear his voice of cheer, and just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me, long life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see his loving care. And though his heart grows weary, I never will despair. The day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me, long life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know. Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. Ask me how I know he lives within my heart.
It's Easter Sunday morning. You have to say he lives because he does. And our life is what it is as a believer because of what Jesus did on the cross and that he rose again as we celebrate today. Now we're going to sing that again. My Redeemer Lives. His words are coming up there. It's just, I know he rescued my soul.
I know he rescued my soul. His blood has covered my sin. I believe. My shame he's taken away. My pain is healed in his name. I believe. I'll raise a banner, 'cause my Lord has conquered the grave. My Redeemer lives.
We're back to I Know He Rescued My Soul.
I know he rescued my soul. My blood has covered my sin. I believe. My shame he's taken away. My pain is healed in his name. I believe. I'll raise a banner, 'cause my Lord has conquered the grave. My Redeemer lives. my burden. I'll rise with you. I'm dancing on this mountaintop to see your kingdom come. My Redeemer lives. 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 My Redeemer lives.
Amen. Lord, I lift your name on high. This song says you came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, and from the grave to the sky. That's resurrection.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
You know, we lift the name of Jesus on high because he is our King. We've kind of focused in on that thought as well as resurrection today. This next song is You Are My King. It's an opportunity for you to bow your heart before God and name him as King.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me, because You died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, should die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do, to honor you. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, should die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do, to honor you in all I do, to honor you.
Jesus as your King.
Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Amazing love, how can it be
that you, my King, should die for me?
Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, should die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true, and it's my joy to honor you in all I do, to honor you in all I do, to honor you in all I do, to honor you.
What more can we do than honor God as our King on this morning? Y'all can go sit down. I'm going to introduce my granddaughter. We have a special song from my granddaughter, who is a student at Biola College. She'll be graduating in May this year. But she's going to share with us a song that has this theme as King as well. So Anna, come on up. Anna McGinty. She has sung for us once or twice before, but she's going to bless us with a song.
Thank you.
was the moment when the lights went out, when death had claimed its victory. The King of Love had given up his life, the darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners, for every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished, but not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake, veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens roared? Oh, all hail King Jesus, all hail the Lord of heaven. Oh, all hail King Jesus.
Jesus Christ is alive. He rose from the dead. He lives. He lives. We're so grateful. So grateful for what Christ did on the cross for us. But even more amazing is that he left behind an empty tomb. Take your Bibles, please, and turn to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. This chapter is famously known and well known among Bible students, Bible scholars, Bible teachers as the resurrection chapter. This is the chapter that captures and consummates, and from this we get our doctrine, our teaching on the resurrection. The age-old question has always been, if a person die, will they live again? It's quite the dilemma without the Christian revelation of what death is. But I got good news for you. Great news. Actually, fantastic news. Easter Sunday guarantees the death of death. All right? Think about that for a minute. All right? The death of death. Jesus conquered the grave. Jesus conquered death when he himself rose from the dead. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is the great resurrection chapter. We're going to focus in on verses 20 and 26, but let me give you a little bit of background, a little bit of springboard before we dive and swim and wade in the pool of this wonderful, wonderful truth. Beginning in verse 1 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. By the way, Paul wrote this letter to a group of believers in Corinth, and Corinth was kind of a weird place. I've often heard some preachers call it the Las Vegas of the Roman world, and having pastored First Southern Baptist Church of Las Vegas all those years before we came here, before God led us, I hear weird things can go on in that place. Same thing with Corinth. They were a unstable, wishy-washy people, and they would go and chase after truth for truth for truth for truth, but it was all a lie. They'd go from one thing to another thing, and one of the problems was that even in the church that was there in Corinth, some of the people, some of the members had some strange views about the resurrection. Some said that it never happened. Some said that it was symbolic. Some said that there was no bodily resurrection of Christ. It's just that his spirit and soul emanated and you know, transmogrified, as they say. So Paul writes this letter to correct them in all their strange beliefs and strange views. And having been a pastor all these years, I've been in some churches that have some strange beliefs and some strange views, you know, but not here. I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed in this church with the people. And did I tell you that I love you and I love this church? Praise God. Well, so here's Paul writing 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and we're just going to take a look at some of the first verses before we get into our focus verse. Now, I make known to you, brethren, the gospel, which I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, by which you also are saved, if you hold fast to the word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. He uses the term, you're saved. And we're saved by Jesus Christ. We can't save ourselves. We can't do anything good to earn our salvation. Bible says it's impossible. We are saved by what Christ did, what Christ did on the cross, by being nailed to the cross for my sin and yours. Jesus died on the cross. But the story, thankfully, doesn't end there. And 1 Corinthians 15 attests to that the story doesn't end on a death on a cross and a dead young man, 33 years of age, it is believed, dead. He became alive. He rose from the dead. Verse 3, for I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, and that he was buried, and that he was raised in the third day, according to the Scriptures. Now, there's something that is very gratifying about this whole death of Christ thing. when a person was crucified on a cross as a common criminal, they were put in a common grave. And what changed and was a man named Joseph of Arimathea, who offered his grave, very expensive piece of property, by the way. If you have some kind of a burial plan, you know, it costs a pretty penny and things. But if it wasn't for Joseph of Arimathea, who asked for the body of Jesus to have it buried in his grave, Jesus would have been thrown into a common grave, and there would be no proof of the resurrection. There would be no empty tomb. But we have many, 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 many proofs that Jesus died. We have the scripture, of course, and the appearances between verses 5 and 8. I want you to notice the word appeared. Appeared. Jesus Christ, the risen, resurrected Christ, making an appearance before some of his followers and before people. It says here that verse 4, he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. What that means is that it was prophesied. It was prophesied. It was promised in the Old Testament. It says that he was buried and raised. Verse 5, he appeared to Cephas, that's Simon Peter, and then to the 12. So there we see appeared to a small group. Verse 6, after that, he appeared to more than 500 brethren at one time, most of whom remain alive now, but some have died, or the term used here is fallen asleep. One of the criticisms and one of the things that skeptics will go against the resurrection is saying that the disciples hallucinated when they thought they saw the resurrected Christ. It was just a hallucination. It was just a hallucination. And hallucinations can be very real. I once had a massive hallucination. I don't want to bore you by telling you this story because it's not about me, it's about Jesus Christ. But I remember when I was in the Marine Corps and I had the privilege of serving our country, and I spent 13 months on the ground in Vietnam, and I was assigned to a fighting hole, a foxhole out in the boonies. And I stayed awake. I had to stay awake for a couple of days because stuff was going on, if you know what I mean. And I didn't get any sleep. And because of my lack of sleep, I started hallucinating. And I hallucinated that my mother and father and two sisters came to me in Vietnam and sat with me in the open-air bunker fighting hole I was in. We had a conversation and things. It was so real. It was so real. And I remember when I came home, I talked to my mother and father about it, and we had a little laugh, and they definitely assured me that they were not there. It was just hallucination. It was very strong, and it seemed very real. And one of the criticisms of skeptics, they say that the disciples hallucinated. They hallucinated, and they thought that they saw the living Christ. Well, here we see that this was no hallucination. And when it says that he appeared to 500 people at once, verse 6, 500 people cannot have the same hallucination. It's a mathematical, neurological, and psychological impossibility. Jesus rose from the dead, and he appeared. Verse 6, he appeared. Verse 7, he appeared. Verse 8, he appeared. And so with that springboard, let's just spring off the diving board and go swim and wade and paddle in the pool of truth. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 20 through 26. But now Christ has been raised from the dead. Remember, I told you that the church people there in Corinth had some strange beliefs, and some of the leaders were denying an actual body resurrection of Jesus Christ, and they said it was some kind of spooky deal and this and that. And so Paul writes this letter to correct them. And in chapter 15, the great resurrection chapter of the Bible. So notice the correction here. But now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. For since by a man came death, that's, of course, Adam, by man also came the resurrection of the dead, and that's Jesus Christ. Eternal God, the creator of the universe, very powerful God. He spoke creation into universe, and then he fashioned Adam and Eve. We are something unique and very special in the universe. We are something that God brought about and something that God created and fashioned. We see that in Adam all die, also in Christ all shall be made alive. We see here the salvation that we have. Salvation comes by Christ's death on the cross and resurrection. His shed blood cleanses us from all our sin and all unrighteousness. And then, as I said earlier, this all brought about the death of death. So what do you do about Resurrection Sunday? What do you do about Easter other than celebrating Easter once a year? Oh, by the way, this is extra. It doesn't cost you any more. Every Sunday worship service each year is an Easter celebration. Celebrating the living Christ. Every Sunday is biblically Easter. He lives. But then there's that special, special day today that we celebrate. So two things to do about Easter in our lives, in our hearts. Number one, celebrate it. And that's what we're doing today. Celebrate it. Celebrate it. You remember a band called Kool and the Gang? Kool and the Gang. I saw them perform live years and years and years ago. And they put on quite a show. And their famous song is what? Celebration. Celebration. A great song. Celebration. Well, we have a greater celebration. We celebrate the living Lord who's alive and lives forever. And because of that, we have life forever. By the way, let me explain a little bit about what eternal life is. Commonly, we think of eternal life as long life with no death. We live forever in heaven. But eternal life is not just quantity of life, it's also quality. And by the way, we have eternal life right now. We have eternal life. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you have eternal life now. And passing death, or what some people call kicking the bucket, I don't know where that term came in, simply for the believer means just a transfer, a permanent eternal transfer to a much better place and an awesome, massive reunion with loved ones. We celebrate it two ways. Number one, by committing our life to God. If you're here this Easter Sunday and you've never asked Jesus Christ to come into your life as your Lord and Savior, I challenge you to make that decision right now, this morning. How do you do that? Well, you pray a prayer. You pray a prayer like this: Dear God, I thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross. I ask you, Lord Jesus, to come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. I repent of that. Come take control of my life and let me live for you. It's committing your life to God. There's a beginning point. There's a beginning point, a starting point. And then after that, an entire life that is lived for God. It's a growing point too, not just a beginning point, but a growing point, not stagnation, but inspiration, information of the truth of God, but best of all, transformation. We become new people. We are changed. We have a new life in Christ. We have that. We celebrate Easter Sunday as we are today. We commit our life to God, or if need be, recommit your life to God. Maybe there was a time that you loved God more than you do now. I challenge you to recommit your life and love God. How do we celebrate Easter? We commit our life to God and we love God. That's why, God gave 10 commandments through Moses. I always call Moses the Moses who amazes, because his life was amazing. And you know what? As high and holy as Moses is, you know the term, Holy Moses. Moses was a lot like us. He had some failures in his life, big time. And there isn't a one of us here that hasn't had some kind of failure. And the amazing thing is, the older you are, perhaps the more you have of those, but we have a forgiveness, we have a loving God, and when we stub our toe or fail, that can be turned into victory through Jesus Christ. Christ has raised us from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep, a common term in Scripture and in the ancient world for death. We celebrate Easter by committing our life to God and recommitting our life to God. Every Sunday is a fresh start with God, a continuous new beginning, continuous fresh start with God. We commit our life to God and we love God. God gave us the Ten Commandments through Moses. Jesus gave us a commandment. In fact, Moses was asked, what's the great commandment? You know, of the Ten Commandments, what's the great commandment? How did Jesus respond? He didn't quantify the Ten Commandments. He left them as is, rightfully so. But he said instead, a new commandment give I unto you. A new commandment. Some call it the 11th commandment. A new commandment give I unto you. Love the Lord your God with all your soul, heart, and mind. And then love one another. We can easily understand the great commandment in loving God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind. It talks about every area of our life. We love God not just on church on Sunday once a week, but we love God all week long at home, in the marketplace, in the service club or card group you may be with, or poker club you may be with, or auto club group, or wherever, service group. Love God, serve Him, commit your life to God, and love the Lord with all your heart. And then love one another. Love one another. And it'd be difficult to love one another if we don't first have the love of God in us. Because it is His love, the love that of His that's in us, that we can love as Christ loves. So what do we do about Easter? We celebrate it. We celebrate Easter. And every Sunday, by the way, is a celebration of Easter. Every Sunday. Number two, not only do we celebrate Easter, but we communicate Easter. Look what Paul wrote in the very first verse of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Now, I make known to you, I make known to you. Communicate it two ways, a visible witness and a verbal witness, it being our mission, it being our message. Communicate it. Paul said, I make known to you. I shared it, and it is something that I stand in. And Paul's saying, hey, I let you know about it. Our hope is in the resurrected living Jesus Christ. And it's always a good thing to share it, let other people know. It's always a good thing to invite them to come to God's house. It's always a good thing to let Christ live His life in us. When we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, He literally, through the Holy Spirit, comes into our life. And then the remainder of our life here on earth, until the rapture or the rupture or we pass on and go home to be with the Lord, is a witness and a testimony, and Christ living out his life in us. It's his love. It's his character that we learn of and grow in our visible witness and in our verbal witness. We communicate it, as Paul said, I make known. And then we see, not only do we communicate it as a visible witness in our lives, but a verbal witness. It is our message. It is our mission. He's alive, and he lives in us if we've trusted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. He begins this 15th chapter, "I make known to you the gospel, the good news." God loves you new. If you've ever wondered about how can I have a fresh start and a new beginning, it is through Jesus Christ. If you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, I'm going to ask you to just pray a prayer right where you are. I'm not going to call you out publicly or anything else, but a prayer like this. Dear God, I confess I'm a sinner. I ask you to come into my heart and save me. I want to live for you. I can't think of a better time and place than Easter Sunday in God's house to make that commitment and to experience that transformation. I'm going to ask Greg and Audrey to come, and I'm going to ask all of us to stand as we prepare to dismiss our service this morning. Let's stand together, but I cannot do justice preaching this message on Easter Sunday without giving you a chance and an opportunity to join this church, perhaps, trust in Christ. If you trust in Christ, then you've never been baptized, and I'm not talking about being sprinkled. I'm talking about being buried in the water and raised out of the water, a symbol and a picture of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. And when we do that, some way, somehow, we adhere and connect with that very act. Now, there's no saving power in that act. It's something that you do after you've been saved as a witness, as a testimony. So as we sing, the altar call invitation is this. If you've never trusted Christ, to accept him. Maybe you're looking for a church home, and this is where God has led you. Maybe you want to recommit and dedicate your life. Let me ask you this way. If there's ever been a time you love God more than you love him now, you need to repent and say, Lord, I want to begin a new and a fresh loving you, serving you. Yeah, I know I'm talking about the men and women in God's house on Easter Sunday morning. I know. But we always, you know, like a car, you know, we have to tune up. We always can use this version of tune up. Greg, why should we use this?
Wherever he leads, I'll go. Wherever our church, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? I just heard the double opposed. He's opposed to that. God bless you, Robert. I pray that I'll be a good, faithful pastor to you, and we're so grateful that you are part of this fellowship now. We're going to go ahead and dismiss. Greg, will you lead us in a dismissing prayer? Thank you, Greg and Audrey, for leading us on this Easter Sunday. Hey, it's been a great Easter Sunday.
Yes.
Good turnout, addition to the church and profession, and God was so good. So I challenge you to live for Him and enjoy the rest of Easter today with your family and friends. So glad you're in God's house. God bless you. God bless you.
Father, we thank you so much for bringing us together this morning, for all that you've done in your resurrection and all that it means to us in our lives. And Lord, we just pray that as we move through this week, we would take this message to those about us, to those friends and family, that they would see in us the visible message, the verbal message of what you did for us in dying on the cross. And Lord, help us to lift up our own cross and carry it for you, that we might be witnesses throughout all that we do. Thank you for your love. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.